Hey, everybody.
Baptist Joshua here. Let's see.
I'm going to try to start a fire. I'm wanting to burn off some of this wood. Get out of that sunlight. I'm wanting to burn off some wood and use the ashes in my garden. So, let's see what we can do. Figure I'll start the fire. Try to start it fairly quickly. I know sometimes you can do things to start them slowly, but just got some old paper here. And let's throw a couple charcoal just to help it along. I'm just playing around with this, thinking about the idea. My sister's been thinking about the concept of using cotton swabs for helping to start a fire. So we'll see how that works. She might have wanted to put oil or something on it, I don't know. It's getting hot. Those charcoal pieces to burn. Where there's smoke. Yeah, I don't see anything. Well, it's really hot, but it's not flame. Maybe I should have used a little oil. See, this is the reality. You always see all these TV shows, or especially, you'll see, videos and stuff, they'll teach you how to start a fire, but it can be a lot more difficult, especially when you're not in ideal conditions. Today it's slightly windy, so I've got some stuff here. I don't expect the fire to be too tall, so I may have to move this cardboard. Right now I'm just using it as a wind barrier to not blow the fire that way. We'll see how that goes. It's almost over by the charcoal. I'm trying to get by the charcoal. And of course, I'm not an expert, but I've had backyard fires for quite a few years. It's still on fire, but in reality, is you almost always need more than what you think. Now, of course, this is February. May not look like it, but it's actually February. So, things have a certain natural state of wetness. Maybe in summertime it'd be a lot easier. And I've started many fires with one match. I'm sure. Most of the time it takes quite a while. I mean, you have to work at it for a while. Maybe there's guys who knows how to do it, set up just right where it doesn't have that, but I don't know. Trying to light those charcoal pieces on fire, but having a little bit of trouble. Maybe because they're too far down inside there, I can't see them. I wonder if I can. Man lights hand on fire by accident. You know, how many times have you tried to start a fire in your own grill? Charcoal. Of course, it's windy, so it's blowing them out. So, I guess part of my point is expect more. You have to do more than what you think. If you have one match out in the middle of the woods, you're not necessarily going to survive off that. You know, you're not going to necessarily start your first fire off one match. And burn. Going. Now it's burning. Let's see how it goes. And sometimes I'll throw in several matches just to help it. You know, you toss in a couple, and when the fire hits it, she flames up. So I might toss in a match or two that's just live, helping, you know, hoping to help it start up. There you go. Hope you caught that on camera. I saw it from my angle. When the flame reached one of the matches, I heard it buzz up and the flame increased quite a bit inside the box. But I find often in wintertime or on a spring day when it's not been real, real hot and dry, it can take quite a while to start a fire. Ideally, you'll start out with something like oil. Lamp oil, that really starts really quickly. Sometimes I'll just, you know, put a couple glugs into something and just start it on fire and boom, I'm ready to go. But like I say, you know, sometimes when it's really, really dry out, you can just start a match with one, start a fire with one match. I like to use paper to get going. But I got so much wind going on around here that it's helping to flame it on, but it's also helping to put it out. And that looks like it's out. There's a little bit of fire going on in there, I think, but yeah, it's starting on fire in the back. She's burning pretty good in the back. Here she comes, the smoke. I personally don't care a big deal for the strikers. I've had a lot of trouble with strikers. Here's the biggest thing I can give you for my advice in the human realm for surviving. In the spiritual realm, obviously ask God for help if you're in a situation. And if you're not in a situation, ask God for guidance for what to buy for such a situation. But in the human realm, what you're doing, whatever you buy that you think you're going to use for survival, try it out first. I bought a Schrade SCHF9 knife. That was my intended knife for my survival knife. That, you know, if everything goes crazy and, you know, you're in trouble, I'm going to slap that thing on my belt and that's what I'm going to use. So I decided, you know, it's so beautiful, it's so nice, I just can't stand the thought of chewing it up by actually using it, but I needed to prove it. And even David in the Bible talks about, you know, he can't use certain armor and sword and all that, I think, because he hadn't proved it yet. Well, I can take a knife and buy it, and it's my ideal knife that I think I'll use, but if I've never actually tested it in reality, what's going to happen if I rely on that knife and I hit it with something and it shatters? I'm in trouble. So I have started to abuse that knife. I'll take that knife and I'll split wood with it or carve up wood or whatever, and I won't make it last. And the odd thing is that it still looks practically brand new. I mean, it's just, I've done a lot to it and it still looks like it's, I might even think it was still brand new. So I really like that knife. It's a heavy knife. It's a kind of a Jim Bowie type of a knife. And so I have proved it, and now I trust it. And when I go in the woods, it goes with me. It straps to my belt and around my leg, like an old six-shooter type revolver holster. It feels like one. You feel like you're carrying a revolver. And I've pulled it at least once when I thought I was in danger out in the woods. We thought we had a bear near us, and it may have been. I pulled that knife, and we were out in the woods behind Bauman Lake in Cherry Valley, Illinois, which there's not supposed to be bears around here, but at that time there had been a bear seen in the area, and my sister and I were out in the woods, and we heard crashing trees, and then it stopped. I just stopped and was praying for our safety or something. And then it had been on the right side of us. You could hear crashing trees and rushing. And then on the left side of us, suddenly we heard something crash into the river and the geese go crazy. And we were very, very careful. We crossed a creek heading back towards the lake because we wanted to get out of the woods. And then I heard the sound, which is that is not a good sound to hear. That is, if that was a bear, and it sounded like it was, when they chomp their mouth like that, they, like that, that's, you're in trouble. They're upset. And I heard that, and I froze, and I waited, and I probably prayed some more, and then we crawled up the side of an embankment of the creek, and went out into the middle of a field near there that was not being used at the time, and we went out in the middle of a field to get away from the woods, so that if a bear did come, we'd be able to, you know, hope, well, at the time I was thinking we could run, but I don't know you'd want to run from a bear, but I don't know, but we got out of there. I never did find out if it was a bear. I did report it, I think, to DNR. I don't know. I've gone in the woods since then, never had that sound, never heard, had that trouble. I did one time go out and saw what looked like scratchings on a tree that were up about 6 to 8 feet high, which it looked like a bear had just taken his fingers and raked it. But then I looked down at the snow, and there was pieces of the bark all over the snow, but no prints. So then I knew it was just natural. Sometimes trees apparently just shed their bark like that, and it looks like something has scratched it. I think it even had finger strikes, but that's just the way that bark fell off, because there was no prints in the snow, but there was plenty of bark all over the top of the snow. So I knew it was natural, and it happened after the snow without anything stepping on the snow. So, I don't know. Do you think this thing is on fire yet? I think so. Another thing is, don't add your kindling too quickly, and don't add it too much too quickly. You can smother the fire. I'm just adding it a little quicker because some of this wood has already been on fire before, so it's probably going to burn a little easier. Although, we did have really, really strong rain lately. A lot of rain. But, looks like it's working. So I'm just wanting to add this ash back into the garden. I do not burn plastic for two reasons. My original reason for not burning plastic is I didn't want the plastic chunks in my garden. And then later I watched a documentary and found out about, I think it's called dioxins. Pretty sure it's dioxins. Anyways, it's a poison that is released from burning plastic, and it is incredibly dangerous. You don't want to mess with it, I guess. So, causes a lot of troubles, causes birth defects, cancer, all sorts of stuff. And, yeah, you don't want to mess with that. So, I don't burn it, because I don't want to inhale it. I don't want it being spread to someone else. And so, one time I was out at my uncle and my cousin's little farmette that they had, and someone threw a black trash bag into the fire. And I went over and yanked it out, and when I yanked it out, I jerked it, because it was on fire, I think. I jerked it. Well, it had already begun to molten, and it dripped plastic, molten plastic, on my arm, which felt really good. It sprinkled it on my arm, and then ate its way through my skin, and I had, I don't know, 16th, 18th, an eighth of an inch, something like that, hole in my arm, the underside of my elbow. And two spots where it just ate its way down, and I was wiping it off real quickly and trying to get it off, and it hurt. And so I don't like having scars, so I kept basically every day asking God to heal my arm to make the scars go away. I didn't want to have scars, and they're gone. I don't think I have anything there at all. I've done that with other scars that I've had. But I'll ask God, pray every day that He'll heal them. And then I'll look, and they're lighter and lighter and lighter, and then eventually they're just gone. So. People don't. God's not a sugar daddy. He's not. You should pray to Him and ask Him for things, but He's not there just to fulfill your wishes. I mean, there's other reasons to pray. And He'll do more for you than what you might think. I've had some pretty interesting things happen as I prayed about it. Some very interesting things have happened. And, if you ever see the movie Facing the Giants, man, especially with atheists, if there's any atheists watching, I mean, that's not make-believe, that kind of a movie, if you've ever seen the movie. And if you haven't, go watch it. It's a good movie. Facing the Giants is about a Christian guy who gets right with God, and then you start to see God work. It's fictional, but in the movie, you start to see God work in his life, and all these amazing things happen. And my mom and I were one time watching it, and she was, I think, talking about a friend of mine who's an atheist, and saying, you know, that he needs to know that that is what a Christian's life can be like, and what our life is like. Some of the things that have happened with us. So, I may have mentioned this in another video, but I highly recommend keeping a prayer journal. I personally don't keep a prayer journal in the sense of every time I pray for something, I write it down, because I don't want to have to go back and check everything and find out whether or not it was answered. I just write, and you can do that, and that may be fine. I don't like to do that. Plus, there's going to be a lot of prayers you're going to pray about, and they never are answered your way. So then you don't write them down. You think they were never answered, but maybe the answer was no. Maybe the answer was later. Maybe the answer was much later. So I just keep an answered prayer journal. And I usually enter in every day some answered prayer. You know, if a loved one travels and you ask for prayer for them to be safe and they come back safe, that you can call that an answered prayer. So you can, you know, you can post something in that journal every day. If you have an active prayer life, then you'll notice things happening. Wonder what this will do. Smoke. Imagine that's how the Indians used to make smoke signals. They build a fire, and when they went to build up some smoke, they had a little bit of grass or leaves or something, it produces a white smoke. Now where I live, you can't legally have a fire unless it's something like this, where you're doing it for a reason. You can't just burn off stuff. You have to have an active reason. Me, I'm making a video, I'm just sitting here enjoying it, and I'm using it for the ashes. But I couldn't just, like, burn off my grass or burn it, which is, I think would be kind of stupid anyway. And you can't burn off your leaves and stuff like that. I mulch. So I mulch all that back into the soil. Anybody who takes their leaves and sets them out to the curb, or takes their grass and sets it out to the curb, you're doing damage to your property, because you're taking the nutrition, the nutrients, the vitamins, whatever that's in the soil, the fertility of the soil, and you're giving it to someone else. Why would you do that? That doesn't make any sense at all. You know, when you give the grass and the leaves to the trash company, at least my trash company, they take it out in the country. They basically grind it up, put it into a long strip of piles, and then they let it decompose till it turns to dirt, and then they turn around and either sell it or give it back. I think they give it back to people. So that's nice. But so it doesn't go to waste. So it's not, you know, at least in my area, it's not going to waste. But how is your ground going to get more fertility? And then people, they throw away all their leaves, they throw away their grass, and they buy fertilizer for their soil, and they walk around, part-time job, walking back and forth, putting fertilizer, artificial usually, on their property. So my soil is extremely fertile. One of the symptoms of a fertile soil is that you have, what is it, lamb's quarters or sheep's foot, I think it's called. What is it called? There's a certain plant, a green plant. It's also known as wild spinach. I want to say it's called lamb's quarters, but it looks like a turkey foot. It's a little green leaf. Looks like a turkey foot or something. and at least the true one is edible. You boil it like cabbage. Some guys learn about that for survival, like me. I learned about it from an organic farmer nearby. And he said that's a symptom of fertile soil. So that's cool. And we grow it, you know, it grows on my property. Hey, Mr. Kitty. Hi, Kitty Kitty. Hi, Kitty Kitty. One of the local cats is coming by. Mama Cat.
Hi, Mr. Kitty Bash.
You want to say hi? Whitey. Leo. Come here. Let me see if I can get you on video. Maybe I'm too close to the fire. She must not want to get too close to the fire. Well, that's all I can think of to say for today. Maybe God willing, I'll make another video or just enjoy the fire. But hope you enjoyed this video. I like comments. If you subscribe, please let me know, because a lot of people have it set up so that they subscribe, but I have no idea who subscribes, because that in their settings they have it not publicly available. So if you do subscribe, you know, please let me know. That'd be great. Or if you like, if you click like, please let me know. That'd be great. Thank you. Have a good one.